work very much. So I think it's the friendship, I think, with very natural. I have two reasons to be happy. One, because we have a friendship developed over the year, and because I admire very much his philosophical work. He's well known, of course, especially because of his papers on realism. But I will talk about something else. Mario, perhaps you don't know this very much, but you're not very familiar with his works on this issue. But Mario has worked on non-denoting, say, the topic of this paper. And as regards this, we may say it's an anti-realist, as I think, in the sense. Not as real as man, as Meinong is regarding non-existent objects. Meinong, we may say, is a realist who overdid it, perhaps, in a sense. It's so realist that he believes even in non-existent objects. Mario has written in this, and he defends Meinong, so it might seem that. He follows Meinong's path, but he wants to read Meinong in a way that is different from the way it's usually read. So let me rehearse some prehistory first. So this is a topic that I've been working on very much. It has been my main topic, perhaps, for a long time. So since my master's thesis, my PhD thesis, I wrote a thesis that defended the binomial position, the one proposed by my mentor, Ettore Castagnera. But then later on, after finishing my PhD, I worked on another approach. I followed the different path, which also was inspired by one of my teachers, namely Cocchiarella. This approach, in turn, was based on a way of reading Fastel's approach in the principles of mathematics. A long time ago, in this very university, I presented my view. It was 2004. There was a conference on mind, and I presented my Russellian view, but a Russellian view based on not on the non-denoting, but on the principles of mathematics. And Mario commented on my talk, as you can see from this other picture. You can see discussant Mario Alai, and. And after commenting on my paper, Mario expanded his reply. He published a number of things on this issue. In particular, speaking of non-existent objects, which was published in Meinong Studies in 2006. And before that, there was a paper in Italian in Vista Estetica, and we engaged in a correspondence in that period. And the correspondence ended, according to my records, with the reply of mine on August 10, 2006, in which I said, Mario, thank you very much for sending me your paper on this topic, the one which was then published in my own studies. And I gave a short reply. And I sort of promised a full reply, but then a long time has passed by and I never wrote this reply. Meanwhile, Mario has written more on this topic. Here are some further publications by Mario, even a big book on philosophy in Italian, sort of. A textbook on philosophy of language, in which there is a chapter on topic I will discuss today. And I myself wrote more on these topics. My reply to Mario never came. And this is my chance finally. I want to address this issue again. Let me make it clear that all over these years, in this works, I've defended the descriptivist point of view regarding proper names and indexes. So I will be talking about definite descriptions, but my approach could be extended to all sorts of singular terms. I view all singular terms as somehow expressing, denoting concepts in the terminology of Russell's principles of mathematics. So a little preview of what I will do. Let me say that, okay, even though Mario has written more on this topic, as I said after his paper speaking of non-existent objects, I think that remains his most explicit treatment of the topic, and my subsequent works do not change the picture in essential ways. So I will present the view that Mario calls neo-Russellianism, because this is inspired by the principles of mathematics by Russell. So I will rehearse my view briefly. And then I will talk about the problems that Mario sees that view. Despite these problems, Mario acknowledges an affinity with this view. There are six examples that Mario discusses. And to compare our views, and we go through these examples of case studies, I don't think we'll have time to really do this, to really treat all of them, but I will consider at least a couple of them. And I hope this will be an instructive tour. So these are the case studies. The present king of France is bold, famous example by Russell. The golden mountain is golden. Sherlock Holmes was clever. Frank thinks of the golden mountain, probably Mario, myself in mind, probably when he chose the name Frank, I suppose. The round square does not exist. The dagger is over my head, said by one who is having a hallucination. All these cases involve non-denoting terms, you can see. So let me offer you a brief sketch of my view. Let us call it neo-Russellian, following what Mario says in his paper. So the basic idea is to go back to the denoting concept of Russell's principle of mathematics. What does Russell say about denoting concept? Well, consider a sentence such as "the teacher of Plato is a philosopher." Russell says, well, here there is a denoting concept that occurs in the proposition, a denoting concept such as "the teacher of Plato." This occurs in the proposition expressed by the sentence. So the proposition then is not on the other hand, the proposition is not about the teacher of Socrates, but it is about Socrates because this denoting concept somehow denotes Socrates. This is Russell's idea. But we can say something similar about sentences such as "every man is mortal" or "some man is mortal," in the sense that, in these cases, the proposition expresses, I'm sorry, the sentences express propositions that in which denoting concepts occur, denoting concepts such as "every man," "some man." So the denoting concept expressed by a definite description is a special case. It's a peculiar denoting concept, but there are other denoting concepts Why do we want to go back to the denoting concepts of the principles of mathematics? Because we have to do with, we have to deal with problems that the point, we may say, the approach that Russell, developed shortly after the principles of mathematics, namely the account of non-denoting. Problems that were pointed out, especially after the Meinong Renaissance in the 70s, 80s, and 80s, I would say, of the last centuries, where many new Meinongian philosophers wanted to resurrect Meinong after Russell's criticism. Among them, my teacher, Cocchiarella, people like Terence Parsons, Routley, and also Zalta. Problems having to do with sentences such as the ones that Mario picked up as case studies, for example, the golden mountain is golden. But others, there are other examples as well. For example, the famous sentence by Gitch, "Hope thinks that the witch has blighted Bob's mane, and not wonders whether she killed Cobb's soul. Polyphemus is taller than Superman. The Ulysses of the Odyssey is the Ulysses of Dante's Inferno." See that if we see that all these sentences can be true. This is we can imagine situations in which they are true, and but if we apply literally, stubbornly, the theory that we find on denoting, we cannot account for the truth of such sentences. But by appealing to denoting concepts, we can. This is the idea. And but what are denoting concepts? The idea is to understand them as properties of properties in a type-free property theory. This is, of course, it's not something that we find explicitly in Russell, it's not there. It's a proposal that comes from my other teacher, Nino Cocchiarella. So we take for granted that we have type freedom. So, for example, we can make assertions such as Judith White's, in which the property of wisdom, of course, as property predicated something. But we can also say wisdom is desirable. So the very same entity, wisdom, of course, as argument in subject position, and we predicate of it another property, desirable. We also assume that we can also have complex properties, for example, bachelor being male, and adult and unmarried, property here. And we understand complex property, complex properties by assuming this law of lambda conversion. We call it so because following church, we use this symbol lambda to capture formally complex properties. So basically, if I predicate this complex property of John, the property of being bachelor, I am saying that John is married, that John is adult, and that John, sorry, that John is male, that John is adult, and that John is not married. Now, the denoting concepts are very sort of rather complicated the complex properties. For example, the denoting concept sang Greek is this complex property. So the property of being such that there is an X which is Greek and X is Q. So being a Q, being a property Q such that there is something which is Greek and which has the property Q. If I predicate this of the property being mortal, I get something equivalent to there is something which is Greek and it is and it is mortal. So basically I recover by lambda conversion the standard way of expressing this in first-order logic. But the advantage is that there is a term which is directly the meaning of some Greek. So in a sort of compositional way, we can say, well, some Greek has the meaning, as meaning this denoting concept, mortal, as meaning the property mortal, we compose them in a compositional fashion. Then by lambda conversion, we can recover the standard way of representing this in first order logic. When I say the US president is a Democrat, there is something similar. I predicate a denoting concept of the property Democrat. The complex, the denoting concept is a bit more complicated. It is this one. It has inside, so to speak, basically the standard Russellian analysis of definite description. So if I apply lambda conversion, I get a formula. There is an X. There is something which is a U.S. president. There is only one U.S. president. Second clause, and this X. This entity is a Democrat. Okay. This is basically, you find this idea in Richard Montague, in his famous paper, The Proper Treatment of Quantification in Ordinary English. Cocchiarella, who was my teacher, was a student of Montague. We learned this from him. He gave me some ontological account of this approach. From his point of view, this predicates, for example, this one, stand for properties of properties. Montague assumed Russell's type theoretical approach, but from Cocchiarella's point of view, we should accept type freedom. And the advantage is that we can then speak of this, somehow we can speak of these properties of properties, we can predicate properties of them, and they can play the role of Meinongian objects, so to speak. This is the basic idea. Let me show some abbreviations that I will use for convenience. So you have seen that the formula that stands for a denoting concept is rather complicated, but let's abbreviate in this obvious way. For example, we had the term the US president, it stands for this denoting concept here, over there. Here we have already an abbreviation, the numeral one, which points out that we have unicity. A further abbreviation here, a definite article that we are all familiar from it by our knowledge of English. So for example, the golden mountain can be taken to mean this denoting concept. Now this the representation is very simple. They, G and M, you may say, G is the property of being golden, M is the property of being mountain. Okay, but this is an abbreviation. In the end, really, we have a more complicated notion, which is here. It involves quantifiers, the identity, other operators like the if-then operator. Now, the denoting concept cannot occur as concepts in a proposition, as when I say the US president is a Democrat. So this really means predicating the denoting concept, the US president, of the property being a Democrat. But this is equivalent of asserting something in first order logic by lambda conversion. So really what I mean to say in the end is that there is exactly one entity which has the property of being a US president, and this entity is a democrat. But the denoting concepts can also occur as arguments in a proposition. This is the advantage of having type freedom. Crucial this. So for example, when I assert that someone X thinks of the golden mountain, I can represent this in the following way. Okay, there is a relation, thinking relation T, which relates an entity X to a denoting concept. The denoting concept, the golden mountain. Making this assertion doesn't commit one to the existence of a golden mountain, because when the denoting concept, the golden mountain, occurs as argument in the proposition, you cannot perform, so to speak, lambda conversion. You cannot infer that there is an entity which has the property of being golden and mountain. So in this way, we can capture binomial intuitions by appealing in the denoting concepts. So for example, Meinong wants to say that the golden mountain is golden might be a true proposition. How could that be? Well, we can accept that if we understand that this predication is as something that I call involves. So the idea is that, so we can say that somehow this denoting concept, the golden mountain, involves the property G. In which sense? In the sense that G is a constituent, we may say, of the denoting concept. You see, the property of being golden, of course, as a constituent of the denoting concept. Or perhaps in the sense that the property being gold and mountain implies somehow another property. For example, being a mountain implies having a height of at least 600 meters. So in this sense, we mean 600 meters above sea levels. So we may say that in a sense, the golden mountain has a height of at least 600 meters above sea levels, but in the sense that the property of being mountain implies that this other property. So I represent this in symbols in this way. It is this sort of membership symbol or this sort of implication symbol. So there are two ways in which you can understand the is of predication involved in this sentence, the golden mountain is golden. So by having the denoting concept in subject position, we can find a way of saying that in some sense this proposition can be true without any commitment to a golden mountain. Now, of course, if you have complex properties, classical logic, and time freedom, you can have logical paradoxes, as it well known. For example, Russell's paradox, and Cocchiarella uses the notion taken from Quine of homogeneous stratification to deal with logical paradoxes. To me, this is unsatisfactory. Particularly, I've written a paper long ago in which I show that you can derive a version of Russell's paradox with that approach. So I deal with it in other ways. I've written that, but that's another complicated stories that I must skip. Now let's move to Marius' view. And to Marius' assessment of my view. There are agreements and disagreements here. So in a sense, both I and Mario want to do the same thing, namely somehow reconciling Meinong and Russell and even Frege somehow. And what I do in an effort to do this is to appeal to denoting concepts, and in particular to what I call determinative denoting concepts, namely the denoting concepts expressed by the definite descriptions. So with them, I want to capture what Frege does with senses and what Meinong does with objects, essentially. Mario appeals to what he calls concepts of objects. It's the terminology that I extract from his papers. And he tries to interpret sentences in Grasserian, Frege, and Meinongian ways, and typically he tries to find something worth in all interpretation. Then I do this to some extent. However, where Mario sides with Frege in taking some sentences in non-denoting terms to be without truth value, I side with Russell, I take all of them to be false. A point on which we disagree is where has to do with how to interpret Mario. So Mario interprets Meinong as not really ontologically committed to non-existence objects. Here is a quotation. I will not read, but you can read it if you want. And once he has understood Meinong in this way, he seems to buy what Meinong says. So according to him, Meinong would be committed to concepts of objects rather than to objects. For example, is committed to the concept of the round square rather than to the round square. Now, I cannot see this in Meinong. I take him as literally is committed to objects, and in particular to non-existent objects. As such, I reject him. I want to be a naturalist like Russell and Frege. But in essence, I think that in order to be actualist at the same time taking into account what we might call the Meinongian data, all those sentences that seem to be true and following Meinongian intuitions, so in order to account for them, it's a good idea to appeal to the denoting concept. So to go back to the Russell's or the principle of management. So I would say Meinong, as interpreted by Mario, really does something very similar to what I propose, except that I appeal to determinative concepts, which are maybe properties rather than to concepts of objects. I think that Mario has not specified what he means by concepts of objects. I myself have a precise answer to the question, what kind of concepts are they? And namely, they are properties of programs, as I say. Now, there is, however, a misunderstanding that I hope we can finally clarify. So Mario, I think, wrongly attributes to me something that I never said, namely that we should involve not so much the denoting concept, the golden mountain, but for example, the concept of the golden mountain, rather than simply the golden mountain. So let us focus on an example to clarify, which is really the case study number 4, Mario's numbering. Namely, Frank thinks of the golden mountain. On my reading of Meinong, 4 is true because there is a thinking of relation that links Frank to a non-existent object. And this object is somehow both golden and mountain. This is what Meinong says. According to the way in which Mario reads Meinong, 4 is true because there is a thinking of mental relation, but this time between Frank and the concept of an object. So that Mario uses this terminology, the golden mountain as such. And this concept is designated in this terminology, that is, it is the meaning of the singular term, the golden mountain. So the golden mountain has a meaning. This meaning is a concept, that is the golden mountain as such. This very term, the golden mountain, lacks a reference. It is a non-denoting term. Nevertheless, Mario says, we speak of non-existent objects in the sense that at least the grammatical subject term may be involved in a true predication, even when lacking preference. So, for example, this sentence would be true even though the singular term, the golden mountain, lacks a preference. But nevertheless, it has a meaning, namely a certain concept. So this is the way I interpret Mario. And so this is the reading he offers of that sentence, 4.6. Frank thinks of the golden mountain as such. In this example, it's not explicit, but I offer the reading on the basis of what it says with respect to the other examples. Now, what would I say is the following instead. According to me, so this sentence is true because there is a sentence, there is again a thinking of relation between Frank and a determinative concept, which I represent in that way, the G and M. And this is the meaning of the singular term, the golden mountain. And this is a term that refers to nothing. So this is the way I will represent in a formal way the English sentence. So F somehow stands for Frank. And there is a T relation between Frank and this denoting concept. According to Mario's interpretation of my view, the other end, four is true because there is a thinking of mental relation between Frank and something like a mental concept, you may say, referred by the following term, the concept, the golden mountain. So that would be the representation, 4.4. Frank thinks of the concept, the golden mountain. And now Mario objects to my view. In contrast, this is what Mario thinks is the correct picture. Frank thinks of the golden mountain. The reading is Frank thinks of the golden mountain as such. But Mario finds something important in his reading, from my view. So he thinks that the 4.4, namely Frank thinks of the concept, the golden mountain, is used somehow. Because, okay, it is true that 4.6 provides the meaning of the sentence form. 4.4, the reading he attributes to me, in his view, has a different meaning, but this meaning is logically equivalent to 4.6. And it is also true. And in his view, this equivalence reveals that 4 or even 4.6 do not ontologically commit to non-existent objects, but rather to concepts. Well, in my view, this reading that he attributes to me really should go out of the picture. I think that it may even be false in a case in which the correct reading that we can provide by using either Mario or either Mario's or my terminology is true. So, for example, if it is true that Frank thinks of the golden mountain, of course, I think that my reading is the correct picture. There is this relation between Frank and the denoting concept. Mario will say that there is the 4.6. Is the right picture. Frank thinks of the golden mountain as such. But the reading that Mario attributes to me, I think, could be false. Why? Well, when is it true that the Frank thinks of the golden mountain? For example, when Frank entertains certain proposition that involves this denoting concept. For example, the proposition, the golden mountain does not exist. Because I entertain this proposition, somehow I'm thinking the denoting concept, the golden mountain, it is, I'm somehow contemplating it, it is somehow in my mind. But in this case, I am not thinking of the concept, the golden one. This is a meta concept that is not involved at all. I would think of it if I were entertaining another proposition. For example, the concept the golden mountain is non-referring, for example. So in my view, clearly 4.4 could be false when 4A or 4.6 is true. This is the way really I would formalize something. The concept, the golden mountain, something like this. Being an X, we need the definite article because we have in the singular term the definite article. Of course, this is an abbreviation, my the in the formula. Then after the which involves existence and unicity, as the two Russellian condition of existence condition and the unicity condition, then the lambda introduces the rest of the property. We are saying that the property is the property of being a concept which is identical to the golden mountain. This is the way I will represent it. So this would be the meaning of a singular term such as the concept, the golden mountain. And this refers to the concept, the golden mountain. In contrast, the golden mountain refers to nothing, and that's the golden mountain as middle. So they are far from being equivalent. Okay, there are further problems, then let me skip them. It's already very late. But we can go to another example, and then I will stop, but we might help clarify both my view and Mario's. The typical Russellian example, the present King of France is bald. The way I would analyze this in the Russellian way is by saying that the meaning is 1A, namely, there is a predication of the denoting concept, the present King of France, or the property of being bald. This by lambda conversion is equivalent 1B, namely the assertion that there is exactly 1X. There is exactly one object which has the property present King of France, and this X is bald. Then, of course, this is false. But we could give a less likely binomial interpretation by taking the is of predication to be involving. In this case, in this interpretation, the present King of France, the denoting concept, of course, in subject position. Okay, we have two slightly different ways in which we can do this, 1C and 1D, they're analogous. In this very case, the sentence would still be false because, of course, the property of being bald is not implied, logically speaking, by the property. Present King of France. So even in this binomial interpretation, the sentence is false. According to Mario's interpretation on my view, the interpretation would be the concept, the present King of France implies the concept bold, but really, as I explained, I really do not claim this. But now it is interesting to see Mario's complaint. He claims, we should say that this sentence is neither true nor false because he wants to follow Frege strongly here. And according to my interpretation, it would be false because the concept body is not really implied. Now, this is a point where we are in disagreement because Mario wants to follow Frege, as I said. So in his view, this is the right picture, the we should offer. So the sentence is the present king of France is bald. And he wants to read it in this way. The one thing whose existence is here presupposed but not asserted, that is presently king of France, is bald. And this lacks a truth value. Because existence is just presupposed, not asserted. Mario is very nice though, and he doesn't really want to rule out the Russellian reading. He has a very conciliatory attitude. So he claims that we could interpret the sentence in a Russellian way, even though it is less likely. But the preferred interpretation is Prosonian or Frevian. He says, well, upon hearing this sentence, our natural reaction would be that it is false. We would say so if we knew that there is a king in France now and that is ESM said. As pointed out by Strawson, we typically presuppose the existence of exactly one king of France without actually asserting that it is false. But the failure of our presupposition makes us unable to actually make an assertion, that is to say something that is either true or false. Okay, as I said before, yeah, he admits that there may be a Russellian reading, but it's less likely. My reply is that having clarified the meta conceptual mistake, which I do not really make, as I said, my reading is purely Russellian, 1A, a reading which makes the sentence false. And I claim that this is an advantage. It is better because we save classical logic. We do not have the complication of dealing with truth value gaps, and we can explain otherwise our discomfort with respect to an utterance of one. Let's make this comparison. If somebody says John stopped smoking, we may be surprised to hear it if because we know, let's suppose, that John never smoked. So we may point this out. And nevertheless, John stopped smoking is false. It's false because to stop smoking, one must have smoked, and John never smoked. So we can still say that. So it may seem, okay, there is a presupposition failure, but nevertheless, we can take the sentence to be false. Okay, there are a lot of other issues that could be discussed, really, but I want to make a long story short because it's late and we'll have to leave some time for discussion. Perhaps I very shortly I can discuss this interesting example. The dagger is over my head. Mario claims that in my neo-Russellian reading, I cannot offer a reading I cannot offer any correct interpretation of one possible reading of this sentence. Namely this reading, the dagger, the one I am seeing, whether real or not, is over my head. It is that I may be having a hallucination. I say something about the dagger that I see without committing myself to it being an hallucination or being something real. But I think that I can offer a representation of this, and so we'll say reading of this, which is, would be the following one. Okay, I would say that the reading is in this case 6.4 number 8, namely The dagger with an asterisk, I will explain what it is in a moment, is predicated of all with an asterisk, namely the property of being over my head with an asterisk. What I mean when I use this asterisk, I mean that really this predicate stands for properties such as dagger looking or over my head looking. So I make claims about properties of sense data or visual images in the private visual field of myself and the speaker. As opposed to making claims such as the dagger, so the noting concept is predicated of being over my head, which is equivalent by to lambda conversion to the following formula. There is exactly an X, which is a dagger, and it's over my head. This would be false if I'm having an hallucination. But the other sentences can be true, and very well be true. I'm saying that there is exact, basically what I'm saying is that there is exactly an entity in my visual field, which has the property of being dagger-like. And it has also the property of being the, over my head like or over my head looking. So the denoting concept that I express would be this one, the dagger with an aspect, the dagger-like entity, essentially. Okay, that's all I can say for today, so let me conclude with a summary. Okay, once it is clear that I do not make the meta-conceptual mistake, then there is not much disagreement, I think, between me and Mario. Basically, we disagree on how to interpret Meinong and on the acceptance of truth value gaps. I do not want them, Mario is ready to accept them. We both invoke concepts rather than Meinongian objects. He attributes them to mine and I don't. And here in this university, I could appeal to authority. Venancio Raspa is a well-known scholar of mine. I think would side with me, hopefully. Further, I take the concepts in question to be properties of properties, as I try to explain. That is, they are predicables rather than a special category of concepts, which I think concepts which are not predicables, as I think Mario said. And I think that in my approach, there is an economical advantage because we must buy properties anyway. So I hope that Mario finally may want to acknowledge this. Let me close with. with a note on a nice day we had at the seaside a long time ago. I cannot date that. I mean, I can date the correspondence we had. I cannot assign a date to that wonderful day we had together at the seaside. And in that day, I learned something more from Mario. I learned a lot of philosophical things from Mario, especially regarding realism. That day I learned that it's very useful to wear something like this when we are late in September and the ski is very cold and you want to take a very long swim the way I like to do it. So we took this long swim together. Mario had already an outfit like that one. And I said, I must buy one. This is mine, it's not Mario's. I don't have a picture of Mario's outfit, of course. Okay, thank you very much, Mario. Thank you.